Gunnar segir beini tala mínu því að þú ert að gera svakalega mynd hrunið sem að verið sýnt 20. janúar kyrstnir og þú varst að sýna með bútur þessari mynd í fyrir dag og þetta alveg frábælega skemmilegt.
Já, þetta hljómar ágætlega allavega, svona, þetta við erum að þvæla svona Evrópu og heiminn að skoða svona, já, þessar ástæður og hvers vegna við lendum í þessu og velta upp svona spurningum og svörum.
Þú ert búin að fara víða?
Já, ég búin að fara töluvest víða og hérna við erum búin að fara til Tortóla með þessa, komið þangað og þar eru nú bara hænur og gönnum og svona, huguleg heitt.
Sættu staður.
Já, og þetta eiginlega, við töluðum þar í landstjóran og ritstjóra blaðsins þar og þeir höfðu aldrei séð Íslendinga fyrir þess á okkur þannig að.
Ok. Þeir eru í skúffunum þannig.
Já, þeir eru inn í póstkössum, það var svolítið mikið að póst, svona hólfu, pósthólfu þar sko.
Og þið hafið farið á Guernsey er það ekki?
Við fórum til Guernsey og ræddum þar við fólk sem að tapaði peningum á Landsbanka og við erum búin að tala við fólk sem tapaði peningum á Mön, sem sagt, í Singer og Frílandir og við erum svona búin að ræða við fólk sem að hefur svona, sem að tengir sko, sem sagt, okkur við þessi vandamál, þar að segja fólk sem hefur tapað á þessu sko. Bara venjulegt fólk, bara launa fólk sem var að leggja inn launin sín. Það var ekki að braska með fé. Og við höfum svona verið að reyna að forðast það mikið að vera að tala við fjárfesta og slíkt heldur svona en reynt að horfa svolítið á hinni almenna borgara sem hefur tapað peningum á.
En þið eru búin að safna miklu efni og þú kemur hérna og þú ætlar að leiða mér að sýna bara viðtal sem að var tekið núna í vikunni.
Já, það var við Tony Serer sem var sem sagt forstjóri Singer og Frílandir þegar Kaupþingsmenn keyptu það og Ármann og nokkur Þorvaldsson tók við það því. Og mér finnst svolítið fyndið að við skulum vera Já, sem sagt að menn skuli svona geta leift sér það að keyra svona stóra hluti nánast til fjandans á Íslandi og ætla svo til sem að kaupi bókina þeim allt saman. Já. Ég veist þetta bara fyndið og honum finnst það líka dálítið honum Tony sko. Já. Og hann hefur svolítið mikið og merkilega hlut að segja. Ég veist bara, þetta maður vindu okkur í það.
Sjáum þetta við tala við Tony Serer.
I mean, there's two incidents in Armand's book that immediately spring to mind as being untrue. I mean, one of them is he refers to the fact that throughout 2008 there was no liquidity problems within Kaupthing, Singer and Friedland and they had money coming in. Well, the reality is they took £530 million out of Kaupthing, Singer and Friedland in the Isle of Man and put that into the UK to shore up the liquidity position in the UK. So he doesn't bother to mention that. And the reason why people in the Isle of Man have lost money is because more than half the total assets were put into Kaupthing, Singer and Friedlander in London and lost. The other obvious example where what he says is untrue is he talks about the fact that he got great confidence in the middle of 2008 because an investor from the Middle East suddenly bought 5% of Kaupthing's shares. What he omits to mention is that the money was lent to that investor by Kaupthing itself with a guarantee that he wouldn't lose money on it. So he positions this as being somebody who got great confidence in Kaupthing into the middle of 2008, when absolutely that was clearly not the case. It was another misleading lie. No, his book, I mean, to me, his book was, I'm not sure why anybody would write a book like that, because it just makes you look, I mean, as I read it, okay, I know the background, I knew some of the events, but you start off by thinking this person's awfully naive, ignorant, arrogant, stupid, untruthful. I mean, you go through all those emotions in reading the book, and it seems to me it makes him look a pretty unimpressive person. I mean, I read the book knowing people have lost money as a result of what happened there. And the real, not just people, the Icelandic taxpayer, but real depositors have lost money in either Kaupthing, Singer and Friedlander in London or Kaupthing, Singer and Friedlander in the Isle of Man. And if you read the book knowing that people have really suffered in that way, you come to a pretty bad conclusion about the author. I mean, Armand's title was, I think, global head of investment banking at Kaupthing, based in London. And I always had the impression that there were three people running Kaupthing. There was Sigurda, the executive chairman, Hreidar Marr, the group chief executive, and Armand, global head of investment banking. And there always seemed to me to be a sort of competition between Hreidar and Armand. You know, almost a resentment from Armin that Hreiðar had the title group chief executive, and Armin didn't. And Armin wanted to have a title of chief executive, and therefore there was this sort of tension, and particularly to, you know, Armin, I know his view was to Hreiðar, I'm going to run Singer in Friedland, I'm not reporting to you. You may have the title of group chief executive, but that's not what's going to happen. And so there was obviously, from the very early days, quite a lot of friction as to whether these businesses worked together or whether they worked separately. And I was quite surprised that Sigurdur should allow that. But I mean, I think to me, there's a couple of incidents which I remember, which I think sort of sum up Armin. I mean, one was, I was having some trouble with the investment managers. A number of people saw the takeover by Kaupthing as an opportunity to get bonuses or enhanced packages. And the investment management arm was one of those. And they were the most difficult. So eventually, in about September, October, I had a meeting scheduled with them, and we agreed that we'd have a meeting with Armin, with the investment the people who manage the investment managers, Armin and me. And so Armin and I arranged to meet about an hour and a half before the meeting. The meeting was at 2:30, so I could brief him, bring him up to speed, give him my views on what they were going to ask for and his response. And I got an email about a quarter of an hour before the meeting was started saying, hey, I'm late. I'll be a bit late, but we'll just go straight into the meeting. And I emailed him back and said, Armin, I haven't briefed you. I haven't given you any of the background or anything. He never responded, so he turned up about 15 minutes late, went straight into the meeting. And of course, he got ambushed. I mean, they told him what they wanted, and he had no argument or view. And so he conceded stuff which to me was completely inappropriate. Simply because he hadn't bothered. He hadn't bothered himself with the detail. He hadn't bothered to inform himself. The other one was as I was leaving on my last day, the 30th of November, as usual, on a Friday, I chaired the credit meeting. We had a weekly credit meeting, and for the last few months, Armin had been part of that credit meeting. So we finished the meeting, and around about 4 o'clock, 4:30, and I said, okay, thanks a lot. Armin, how do you want to run the meeting next week? And he looked at me. Well, we'll just run it in the same way, Tony. You'll chair it as usual. I said, but Armin, I'm leaving this afternoon. You know, I mean, I won't be here next week. I'm asking you whether you want it to run in the same way or you want to do it differently, because I'm not going to be here, and presumably either you're going to chair it or you're going to ask somebody else to chair it. I mean, pretty important, the credit meeting. It was the meeting where we consider the big loans to lend. And he hadn't even got his mind round those sort of arrangements.